We're back, ladies and gentlemen, on the Philippe Matthews Show, live, late, well, not live, alive, but not live, to the world, doing our late night conversation with Minister Imhotep Alkebulan. He's been the lead minister of Wolf State Community Church here in Sacramento for more than 30 years, and he's, in my opinion, the expert in Kemetic science, African science and history, and the Husia, and we've had several conversations both online and offline, about our journey and about our science, about our contribution to society and civilization. And recently, there has been, you know, it's always funny how we always have to have a conversation about how we harm ourselves, how we self-sabotage our own good. And so there's a new discussion that is trying to loom up about the Hotep and the concept, the terminology, the ideology, the history, and I guess they call themselves intersectionalists, and it's basically the concept of, you know, looking at black issues and issues that affect African Americans in particular, from a political perspective exclusively, but also bringing in all the other aspects that are political. And it's kind of like, you know, it's kind of like looking at what has happened to us in the diaspora and minimizing it to the smallest level, and putting it in comparison to all of the other political issues that have come out of race and the Eurasian. And it's sick, in my opinion. So I had a conversation, I think last week, with Minister Imhotep, and I said, would you do a show on Hotep and what it means and why it's important to us? Welcome back, my good friend.
Oh, man, thank you for inviting me back. It's always a pleasure to be in your midst, even if it's cyberly.
So let's now, you have a PowerPoint that you're going to share with us, which is extremely powerful. And so we're going to have a discussion first, and then we'll go into the PowerPoint. So some of this might be, you know, you might have to, you might say it a couple of times prior to, but let's, for the sake of starting it, what is Hotep? What does it mean? Why is it important to us?
Essentially, the word Hotep means peace or offering. It's on the suffixes of different netters, i.e. Amen, Hotep, Ra, Hotep. When you say Amen, Hotep, it means Amen is pleased, Amen is satisfied. Actually, I feel so strongly about the word Hotep is I named my firstborn son Ra Hotep.
Mm.
So his name means God is pleased, God is satisfied. And it has to do with the setting sun. You know, so if you can picture the sun setting, I mean, if you've ever watched a sunset, and if you're on a plane, the planes, and you watch that sun go down, and it's just complete.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Everything mm-hmm. is at peace, you know. And so that's what it means. But it also means offering, and the glyph that is used is an altar or an offering table.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When people say Hotep, it's like saying Aslam Linkum, it's like saying mm-hmm. it's like saying peace, it's you know, Shalom Akayim.
Mm-hmm.
It's saying peace to you.
Why do you think it's under attack? Not just the word itself, but the movement of it. The concept of it.
I think obviously it must be working. It must be really strong. So there are forces out there that feel it necessary to pull it back a notch, to discredit it, to make it seem ridiculous and irrelevant. And so that's why it's under attack. If you go on YouTube, there are several anti-Hotep, versions. And it's disturbing because that is a sacred word. Yeah, and what it is, it's not necessarily attack on Hotep. It's an attack on African-centered thought. So Hotep is kind of like a euphemistic way of saying, we're attacking African-centered thought. So people that study Dr. Ben, or people that study Dr. Jope, or Dr. Van Sertima, or Malefi Asante, any of the great scholars, John G. Jackson, Dr. Clark, etc., that they are delusional.
Wow.
So wow. That's what it's being said.
So these intersectionality analysis, they say that the Black struggle should be equally prioritized, should equally prioritize all political issues. So they have reduced this African-centered way of living to just a political issue.
Yeah. Now,
that, what I just said alone, if you don't feel that is absolutely absurd, my opinion, something is radically wrong with you. And I don't know how you can be, I had Karen Parsons on show from Fresh Prince of Bel-Air.
Yes, yes.
And she has a organization called Sweet Blackberry. And on her website, they tell stories of hidden Black history, if you will. Mm-hmm. And she was on the website. She has a video of Anderson Cooper doing the black doll, white doll test again.
Yes.
You remember the first one that was done? I think it was back in the, I don't know if it was 20s, 40s, somewhere in that area.
Yeah, 50s, I think.
Yeah. And Anderson recently did it perhaps about 4 or 5 years ago. And these were with children, babies. And they had... The black girl said that, the black girl was, more apt to be mean and dirty and all of, and how does a child, a baby, get a concept of race and racism and institutionalized racism?
You know what? They are very attuned at that age. Children can learn languages, 2 or 3 languages at that age.
Yeah. Yeah,
they're just a sponge, and so if you turn on the Disney Channel for them, and then you know what's beautiful and what's ugly, what's smart and what's dumb because of the images that are being shown.
Absolutely.
So
my point in bringing it up is that it's impossible to reduce this to just a political issue.
Well, see. It's not a political issue, it's a cultural issue.
Right.
We are trying to get our minds back. We are performing an exorcism on all of the stuff that we have in our heads. Just as an example, okay? We talked about this earlier. I'm reading just a couple of things from Anthony Browder's Nile Valley Contribution to Civilization, Volume 1. And so he has a couple of quotes here. One from Arnold Toynbee, who's a historian, considered a giant. And this is what he says. He says, when we classify mankind by color, the only one of the primary races which has not made a creative contribution to any of the 21 civilizations is the black race.
Insane.
See, and this type of contempt for our story is rampant in school. Mm-hmm. It's rampant in media, and unfortunately, if parents don't know any better, they transmit those awful things to their children sometimes without knowing it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Sometimes the most harm is not deliberate. It's when it's indeliberate. It's when it's unconscious.
Yes.
And not direct.
Yes.
Which was also interesting. I was watching a video, I think it was from Atlantic Star. It was fascinating because there was a time and a moment, we've had this conversation, you and I, where we didn't believe in, if you will, race mixing. Because we knew the power of maintaining our culture. And that to do so would begin the slow digression and dilution, which is where we have come to be as of right now. Talk to us a little bit about the race first concept from that was originated in Africa. And before there was a terminology called race, or culture first, I would say.
Well, in the book, Destruction of Black Civilization by Chancellor Williams, he said that the people they considered themselves children of the sun because they felt that they were blessed and they were kissed by the sun. The Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey said that we should view things through the spectacles of Ethiopia. You know, and everybody else does it. You name the ethnic group. You know, you don't challenge people from India for being Indian first.
Mm-hmm.
You do not challenge people that are from Japan to view Japanese things and idolize it and want to promote their culture. You don't challenge that. That person, if a person is of the Hebrew religion, you don't challenge that person for being what they are. It's only when Africans, and in this particular case, African Americans want to do it, then there's a problem.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then, so you need to ask yourself, why is that a problem? Why, you know, kiss me, I'm Irish.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I have friends. Some of my best friends. I have a friend that's from Ireland, and he named all of his children. He gave them Gaelic names, and it's no like I'm better than you are, but I appreciate that he has. You know, such admiration for his culture.
An affinity for his culture, absolutely.
We do not have that. I applaud that. I have another friend who got turned on to his Scottish heritage and started blowing bagpipes. And I applaud that.
Mm-hmm.
That is something great. You know, he joined a bagpipe. I might not be using the right phrase. You know, he's in a band where people get in full regalia and mm-hmm. they do that, and that's beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but if we want to look at aspects of ourselves, because many of us cannot do a DNA test, and then there's been some challenges. Through that, it was on mm-hmm. 6 minutes. Mm-hmm. So rather than say, okay, I'm a Wolof, or I'm a Serer, or I'm a Igbo, or I'm a Yoruba, or I'm a Fulani, or whatever, I'm a Shanti, or Fanti, or Waso, whatever, many of us just claim the whole continent.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so if we study Dr. Sheikh Atta Joke, he shows that there's a cultural unity of Black Africa, that you can't, you know, the reason why Africa looks the way it does today is because of the Belgian Conference in 1884 and the Berlin Conference in 1886, where they divided Africa up into that jigsaw puzzle that we see now, irregardless of, you know, ethnic groups. So families are displaced, you know, on borders, etc. And unfortunately, we're still fighting over those borders that we didn't create. So we can't say, you know, although I look at my grandmother and I say, you know, she kind of looks like Shaka to Joke. Maybe my people are Wolof or, you know, whatever. But I can't pinpoint it. So, for instance, in the case of my last name, Alkebulan, it refers to the continent of Africa. So I just, since I can't pinpoint it, I just take the whole continent.
I love that. You know, speaking of Sheikh Anta Dejo, earlier you mentioned from Dr. Browder's book, I forgot the name of the scientist, and I should, the historian who was saying, oh, you know, Africans, as it relates to color, has not contributed anything to. So when we look at Sheikh Anta Dejo's work, and you know, I've had anthropologists on that have confirmed, not that it's necessary, but you know, white anthropologists from, you know, Scotland to come on and confirm that all of us, all civilization, all everything comes from Africa. But even more so than that, it's very difficult to even fathom people who literally were chosen by the sun, by the cosmos, to be the first to walk this earth and to be on this planet for hundreds of thousands of years, long before the arrival of the what we call now the species of the Eurasian. And so, you know, they have done a tremendous job in trying to quell that history, that truth. But Dr. Dejo basically had a two-cradle theory. I would call it a theorem because I believe it's absolutely unequivocal. Mm-hmm. Theory means that, you know, it's kind of still up for speculation and study, but I think it's a theorem. And let's just, for the record, share that, talk about that, and then we can go into the PowerPoint to understand the power of the Hotep, the power of African-centered thought, civilization, and living.
Well, okay, Dr. Jopes, he wrote a book. It's called The Cultural Unity of Black Africa. And so he, in that book, he has what's called the two cradle theory, the Southern cradle and the Northern cradle. And so one of the things that stands out, and we're gonna go through each item in the PowerPoint, but the main two things that stand out are matrilineal, matriarchal, patrilineal, patriarchal. And so what he's looking at is that, okay, in the Southern cradle, the societies was agricultural based. And so the society was centered around the woman. It was more egalitarian. And so, you know, the woman was in high esteem, as opposed to the Northern cradle, where the woman was not. Mm-hmm. She was property, you know, it was just a little bit above serfdom. Now, we're talking about the most pristine aspects of the Southern cradle, you know, because I'm not a romanticist in that not everything in Africa was good, and not everything in Europe was bad. I'm African-centered, not Afro-silly.
Nice.
So I think we need to examine.
That's very powerful.
We need to examine, you know, the positive aspects of our society before we were involved in a cultural arrest mm-hmm. with predators and destroyers. Mm-hmm. And see how that applies today. I like what Dr. Amos Wilson says. He says that culture is what you use to solve problems. Culture isn't like necessarily what you wear or, you know, what you eat or, you know, but it's the way that you saw that a group solves problems.
Wow.
So if we look at the problems that are facing us today, mm-hmm. and you mentioned, you know, our children don't even know what's pretty and ugly. They have it backwards. And so that's what African-centered thought addresses.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Excellent. Okay. So let's go into the PowerPoint.
Okay.
And so we're using, find that little green icon there to share your screen.
Yep. Okay.
There we go.
All right, and let me get here at the top. And so are we ready to begin?
We are ready to begin. I'm gonna mute my, mute everything here on my end. So whenever you're ready.
Okay. So I'm gonna begin with this first glyph. This is the basic altar that I was talking about. And this is the Hotep. That's like the main glyph. There's a loaf associated with it and a box. That's the T and the P. So really, Hotep is just really three consonants, H-T-P. Now, I like this quote from Dr. Asa Hilliard, and he wrote this when he reintroduced the book Stolen Legacy through Richardson Press in 1976. He says, "Mental bondage is invisible violence. Formal physical slavery has ended in the United States. Mental slavery continues to this present day. This slavery affects the minds of all people, and in one way, it is worse than physical slavery alone. That is, the person who is in mental bondage will be self-contained. Not only will that person fail to challenge beliefs and patterns of thought which control him, he will defend and protect those beliefs and patterns of thought virtually with his last dying effort." He goes on to say, "Creators and beneficiaries of belief systems develop a vested interest in the system to the extent that they become conscious of it as a system. Actions are taken to nurture and maintain the controlling system intact. Competing belief systems come to be regarded as pagan, heretical, disloyal, and so forth. Priests or professors are ordained or certified as purveyors of the system, sometimes with the belief that they are objective and scientific. The general public usually accepts and comes to depend upon the doctrine or knowledge. When an occasional scholar, priest, or member of the general public discovers new questions and treatments and new treatments of information, especially information that challenges the bedrock of the belief and thinking system, that person is frequently met with silence, denial, isolation, even death." And that's Dr. Asa G. Hilliard, introduction to the 1976 reprint of Stolen Legacy by Dr. George Jim James. So I was watching this kind of hit piece YouTube against people that are quote unquote Hoteps. And it opens up with a brother who's quoting some information that has been disseminated by Dr. Joel Pookrum. Dr. Joel Pookrum is a medical doctor, a physician. She's been a surgeon, an obstetric gynecologist, and you know, has a lot of credentials behind her name, has done a lot of studying and practical application, and she's left that field to go into holistic medicine. So a person is shown quoting some information of hers, but the information that she presents is not addressed. And then the next thing that is shown was a YouTube clip or video clip of Dr. Carr of Howard University, who is a very accomplished scholar, well-researched, and has a PhD in African studies, and you know, has gone to prestigious universities and is teaching at the Mecca, which you know, Howard University is referred to it as. My son graduated from Howard in 2003, and I happened to observe Dr. Carr and the robe that he had, the graduation robe that he had, and the cap that he was wearing was in this beautiful kente cloth, and I was really impressed by him. And you can look him up, Dr. Carr of Howard University. The next person that was discredited was Dr. W.B. Du Bois, the leading sociologist of the 20th century. He was being clowned for his views on Pan-Africanism, followed by a small hit piece on the Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey, very disrespectfully referred to for his views on Pan-Africanism. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad was not immune from the criticism, as was Malcolm X on their views on Pan-Africanism. And then the next person that was attacked was Dr. Ben. Dr. Ben is very well loved. He just joined the Ancestors a couple of years ago. His credentials were attacked. And one of his main works, Black Men of the Nile and His Family, was attacked because it had not been, quote unquote, peer reviewed. But none of the information that he presented was addressed. Then came an attack on Dr. Leonard Jeffries, who was explaining Dr. Jope's two cradle theory. And so we mentioned that earlier in our discussions, myself and Philippe. So let's just look some of the things that Dr. Jope outlines, his two cradle theory from African origin of civilization and cultural unity, characteristics of the two cradles. One, abundance of vital resources, sedentary and agricultural. This is the southern cradle. Gentle, idealistic, peaceful nature with a spirit of justice, matriarchal family, emancipation of the woman, of women in domestic life. Territorial state, xenophilia, as opposed to xenophobia. It was a cosmopolitan situation, social collectivism, material solidarity of right for the individual, which makes for moral or material misery unknown. The idea of peace, justice, goodness, optimism. In literature, it emphasizes tales of fables and comedy. Now, the Northern Cradle, barrenness of resources, nomadic hunting, piracy, ferocious, warlike nature with a spirit of survival, patriarchal debasement, enslavement of women. And so those things aren't addressed. A city-state, a fort, xenophobia, individualism, moral solitude, disgust for existence, pessimism, and the literature favors tragedy. Next, Dr. Umar Johnson was attacked, and although I don't agree with some of the things that Dr. Umar Johnson espouses, he is a person that is sincerely trying to uplift the consciousness of African people in the diaspora. And so I don't think that he was treated very kindly either. And he's not treated very kindly in many of these videos. And I've never met Dr. Johnson. I have no connection with him. But I think he's someone that, okay, you can take some of the positive things that you like and, you know, just ignore the things that you don't agree with or some of the things that you don't like that Dr. Johnson is saying. But he has a positive message on the one hand. There's attacks on Black nationalism, attacks on Pan-Africanism. And then he goes on to say that these people are obsessed with Egypt. And they don't focus on West Africa at all. You know, there's no evidence that that the majority of the people in Egypt were Black people, etc. And so I return to our subject, which is Hotep. Seeing that got me really riled up. But I return to the meaning of the word, which means it doesn't mean to be in a place. It does not mean to be in a place where there's no noise, trouble, or hard work. It means to be in the midst of those things and still be calm of heart. You know, so I have to go back into Hotep. This is how it is written in glyph. Wonderful Medunetur or Suf language. It's some schools of thought, the Kemetology school of thought refers to the language as the Suf language. But here we see the altar, the loaf, and the box, which is so it's HTP. That's how you see it. Hotep, and here it is again, peace, contentment. It not only means peace, but it also means offering. This is the original Hotep. It's at a place called Abu Ghraib in Kemet. And if I ever make it to Kemet, I want to go to where this is found and I want to take a picture with it. The craftsmanship, the way it was fashioned, we don't have time to go into it for this setting, but master craftsmanship, not made with copper tools, has been espoused by Western Egyptologists. This is just a cursory view of the Medunetur language or the Suf language. And here we see Hotep here, to be at peace, Ka, spirit, the Ankh, life, live, etc. Amen is here. This is how we write Ra. And coming from Sir Wallace Budge, he wrote a lot of things on Egyptology as he referred to it. And these are the different meanings for the word Hotep. Some people, instead of writing it H-O-T-E-P, they write it H-E-T-E-P. One time when the great scholar, Dr. Manu Ampim, visited us here in Sacramento, he told us that where they put the vowels is an agreement that Egyptologists and scholars use. They also use the present day Coptic language to pronounce some of these Kemetic terms. So it means to rest, to be happy, to be content, to be glad, to do good to someone. And so this is why I'm kind of riling against the insidious way that Hotep is being referred to. This is how you write my name, Imhotep. It means to come in peace. And if you see the flowering reed here. It has two legs as if walking. So this is the I. Sometimes it's used as an A. And this is the M. The owl is the M. And then the H-T-P. And that's he who comes in peace. And then I found this wonderful little piece here by a group that does Madunature. And my friends call me Emo. And I found here that Emo means within. And as in Kiswahili, it means within, it is inside, it is included within. So it's sort of akin to meditation and going within. And then continuing on, they said, these people are obsessed with ancient Egypt to the obscurity or to the, you know, abandonment of other places in Africa. There are other great civilizations, and there's no real way that we know that the ancient Egyptians were black people. And so, you know, I included this slide to show that, you know, there's glyphs and there's modern people. And these people are still in existence today. Like for instance, this princess from Rwanda. And you see she has her head tied up. Now, when I was in elementary school, kids that used to have the Corvallis haircut, you know, some of them had what we called a hook head. And but in certain places in Africa, that's a symbol of beauty. And so people actually tie the head up. And if you've ever seen pictures of Akhenaten without his crown on and his wife and children, they all have that hook head. This is how Kemet is written in Medunature or the Suf language, the burnt charcoal, the owl, the loaf for tea. And this symbol here represents a city or town. And generally, this is referred to as the Black Land. And this is how they referred to, one of the names that they refer to, ancient Kemet, which we know today as ancient Egypt. And see, these people are still in existence. African people. And I like to quote Renoko Rashidi when he says, we go from snow to crow. There's no one specific type of African person. There's African people with broad noses. There's African people with thin noses. There's African people with long hair. There's African people with short hair. There's the diminutive African people, which are correctly called Twa, which we use the derogative, the pejorative term of pygmy. There's the tall African, the Watusi, that can average, people can average in that ethnic group 7 feet tall. So we go from snow to crow. There's a wide variety of ranges. And generally, the people that I've been showing these last few slides, they're referred to as the Bija people. Also, there's another ethnic group called the Afar people, very similar in features, hairstyle, dress, customs, etc. Now, this slide here are people from the ancient Kemetic times that are referred to as the Per'a. Remember, there was never a place in the ancient times called Egypt, and there was never a man in the ancient times called Pharaoh. These are names that come later, but these were called Per'a, and these are from various dynastic periods, and even there's a Neter, a Wasir, or Osiris, as he's known to the Greeks, and Amun. And these are other Pernetters. This one particularly reminds me of Dr. Obinga. And then as that hit piece video continued, they made fun of people that wore ankhs. And the ankh is a very sacred symbol. It is, at the beginning of Christianity, it was referred to the crux ansata, the cross with a handle. But see, it also refers to the woman again. We always go back to the feminine aspect, the loop representing the uterus. The cross here representing the fallopian tubes, and we can see that in the diagram. And this staff representing the vaginal canal. Sometimes we say this is the woman and this is the child and this is the man and this is the child. So it's a very sacred symbol of life. And a brother by the name of Nur Ankh Amen looked at the ankh and took his studies in electromagnetism and shows in his book, The Ankh, The African Origin of Electromagnetism, how the ankh and other such items as the jed, etc., are actually electromagnetic devices. And he compares it to things do today, so I'm not going to go into that. There's a book that you can get for your further studies. Now, there's a brother that has a website. It's called the Kiswahili Bantu Research Institute for the Ancient Egyptian Language. And this is how he breaks down the word Hotep. He looks at the consonants, the H, the T, and the P, and he goes into the to Bantu languages, where he discovers where the vowels go. And so he goes, he looks at tau, it means to go down, to sink of the sun, to rest, to be in a settled state, to be in a state of peace, calmness, quietness, composure. And then he goes into the Amazulu Bantu languages and finds hu, which is unchangeable, habitual, customary, action, always, usually, generally. And then po is a particle of locality, time, where, when, while, etc. And then, so this is his understanding of the Medu natural language in the Bantu languages. Again, remember that Dr. Sheikh Atajop wrote that there's a cultural unity of Black Africa. So north, south, east, and west. So Hutapo is how the HTP comes out in his understanding and research. And it means always to be in a state of peace wherever you are. And so I'm going to have to remember that when I see these attacks on African-centered thought, when I see these attacks on the very word Hotep, when I see these attacks on the sacred symbol of the Ankh. And so I think that concludes the PowerPoint today. And thank you for joining us. And we're back.
Thank you, my brother, for that. That was absolutely amazing. Absolutely amazing. Very necessary, very needed. Minister Imhotep Alkebulan, everybody. I mean, you know, some people just don't need an introduction. That was just a drop mic moment. That was just a drop mic moment.
You know, I'm trying to just give thanks to the Most High. You know, I've been looking at this for really since I was 12.
Wow.
I've been looking at this since I was 12, okay? And, you know, I've collected knowledge along the way.
Mm-hmm.
I've evolved. We used to say, just as an example, we used to say, it says, man, know thyself. Mm-hmm. But really, that's on the Greek temples. For in Medu Nature, it says, I know what is in my heart.
Mm.
So that's a difference.
That is a difference.
That's a difference.
Wow, that's powerful. Thank you, my brother.
You're welcome, sir.
We'll see you next time.
Karibu, as they say in Kiswahili.
And I'll say Hotep.
All right, Hotep.